dealing with the traffic. I hope none of you were stuck in it for too long. I'd like to once again thank Professor Goetz Richter for his time and effort and knowledge and fun presentations, and we really look forward to hearing that. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. You are hoping fun. To hear about, well, I didn't make particularly welcome to the young people. I announce it as simple thoughts, but maybe some thoughts are not so simple. I try to make it as simple as possible, but I think we have to achieve simplicity where it's possible, but where it's not, we have to be true to what we're doing. So what I'm going to do in this hour or so is have a look at some thoughts about the art of violin playing in general. Some of you who have been to my previous talks might remember some of those thoughts. And then I want to think about it, mainly about how we translate some of these thoughts into our teaching methodology, or in fact, what is pretty much the same thing, into our practice. Because I think we have to remember that practice and teaching is in some ways complementary, or perhaps is two aspects of the same reality. It's the good news for the teachers, meaning that whenever you teach, you also practice, and it's good news for the students, which means whenever you practice, you learn how to teach. So if we keep that in mind, we can be very clever and make progress wherever we apply our activity. This was one of my favorite things I found on, actually somebody sent to me from Facebook, and this is the reality that we face all in the art of violin. Just imagine if you went to get your appendix removed and you advertised in the newspaper and said, look, I don't really need a proper surgeon, I just need somebody with a sharp knife. I think we wouldn't really have that, would we? And it reflects community attitudes to a certain extent about our art of teaching. And it reflects, in a sad way, the view that teaching violin is actually not really that important to us. And yet we know, as teachers, of course, I'm preaching to the converted, we know that teaching and playing violin is perhaps one of the most important things we can do, because it has such a possibility to modify our entire way of being, not just in a sort of esoteric sense, but in a really very real sense. We know now from cognitive science that an activity like playing a violin or playing a musical instrument full stop has enormous cognitive benefits if it's done properly. Our hardware changes in response to our activities. Our brain is a reflection of our activity in the world. So if you spend it on the tablet and the computer, our brains will change accordingly. And if we spend it with the violin in our hands, our brains will also change accordingly. We know this, science knows this, and we have far too little conversation about this, especially in education, where there's a trend of technology at every corner. But it's quite clear that if you give a five-year-old child a computer tablet, the impacts can be massive to their cognitive development in the long term, for sure. We haven't studied properly because we don't want to study properly, but what I hear and what I read from cognitive scientists is not encouraging in this regard. So we have to defend, as violin teachers and as musicians, we have to defend this enormous capacity of development that we actually deal with. Let's think, first of all, about the art of violin playing in very simple and abstract terms. I have identified initially five things that we have to keep in mind and that will inform both our practice and also our way of teaching. First of all, what are we doing? It's a public thing that has pretty serious consequences to how we approach it. Why? Well, in public we can't turn around, have a cup of tea, for example, and start our performance again. We have to be presentable, our students have to be presentable, we have to have a particular mindset, we have to have a particular attitude, we have to be resilient, etc. I'll go through that a bit more later. Our art is interpretive, that's often forgotten. I read recently a little philosophical section from a book by Susan Langer, and she says something like, the howls of the lynch mob at the gallows are not artistic expressions. They're just basically expressions of emotions that might be cathartic in a way, but they're not artistic, and we often make the mistake, I think, that we regard any form of sound production as relevant to music. But music, actually, the way we know and study it, is very, very particular. It's an artistic form of activity, and it's interpretive in that sense. So there are many more dimensions to that than we need to remember. Not every sound produced on the violin is therefore necessarily of the same relevance. We can do many things with a musical instrument, including having fun and all sorts of things, which you must. But at the same time, the core and essence of our activity, we must remember, is interpretive. And it actually informs quite a lot of things in the way we unravel them in practice or also in teaching. Then, of course, what's important about our art is that we have to be able to play with others. We can't just play violin and learn by ourselves. It's often forgotten. It's often forgotten in our practice and also our teaching methodology. It has the fact that pretty much all our music is a playing with others means we have to have a particular mindset. When we play our line, we must always think of something else. We must teach our students to be able to do that. We cannot just have an automated system unraveling at a particular given speed and temporal order. That's not sufficient. It won't ever create the skills which we need in performance of the kind that we are practicing. And of course, that's often where we spend a lot of our time. What we do is a form that of music making includes an instrument. And it has also ramifications for us, because our technique is of a specific kind. It's movement-based. So we need to understand movement, we need to understand how we learn movement and how we modify it. I think that's very important, because a lot of frustration in methodology arises from the fact that we don't think properly about how movement actually works. So we spend a lot of time in diagnosing mistakes, and then at the same time we miss the opportunity to actually do something about it. So finally, I put something in here which I think it's really important, and it's a slightly abstract concept. It comes from a Georgian psychologist. There's a dangerous individual by the name, I think, of Uz Natze. And he coined the term of ustanovka, which is a comprehensive attitude to what you do that includes basically the entirety of your being. Now, this sounds rather religious and esoteric, cultic almost. But if you consider that you're expecting a student at some points to spend significant amount of time in a practice room by themselves trying to perfect a skill that is in some ways initially very lonely, the attitude with which that has to be done and the intensity with which that has to be accomplished has to be considerable. And with a casual attitude to this, there's not going to be much progress in that. And there's an issue here, I guess, which we confront in various ways. Sometimes students will come and say, well, I just want to play for fun, which is fine. There's nothing wrong with that. But even playing for fun has to be serious in order for it to be artistic. So in some ways, in art, in the art of violin playing, there is no middle way. Whenever we pick up the instrument, we have to actually be serious. Not because we are particularly authoritarian or old-fashioned type of people, but it is because the energies and the attitudes that are generated, that have to be generated in order to sustain the accuracy and the level of engagement, cannot be achieved in any other way except with real intent. Effectively, it boils down to the fact that music is an intentional art form. We are operating with intent and through intent. And if our intent is weak, our playing will be weak. So this is important that we translate, in some ways, all our methodology always to a level of comprehensive attitude to the art form itself. So any violinist in this room and any teacher in this room, I think, we will need to reflect whether our playing or our teaching really is always in tune with a comprehensive attitude to the discipline. And I think it's useful to ask ourselves daily almost, why are we doing something? What is the purpose of what we're doing? Without that investigation of purpose, as I said, we may not generate the energies and the intensity and the focus we need. And in sport, actually, that's common. Sports, motivational psychologists maintain the motivation of the sports people, not just their technique. And there are dedicated training programs for sports people just on that level. We do very little on that. And the consequence often can be that musicians have learned an instrument for 10 years or 12 years, have eroded through this process of, which can be very, you know, demanding and confronting, have actually eroded that motivation, not because of anyone's fault per se, but because of just negligence of maintaining the motivation. They've never been asked or asked themselves in a consistent way, why are you actually doing what you're doing? Are you enjoying what you're doing? Why are you doing it? Tell yourself why you're playing the violin and be truthful about it. Tell yourself every day why you're playing the violin and ask yourself, why is this an important thing to do? And of course, you've got to have answers for that. And we as teachers need to have answers for it too. And we need to be ready for students to say to us, I don't like this. I hate practice. And we have to be able to say, I hate practice too, but let me tell you what, the alternative is much worse. So let's think about those areas, those five areas a bit more. Public performance. Well, it requires a specific preparation. It needs to be resilient. As I said already, we can't stop and start. It's, you know, there's a heightened sense of attention on us. So we have to, the relation between the body and mind have to be clear. We have to know exactly what we're going to do in front of people. If we don't know in the practice room exactly what we're going to do, we're never going to find out on stage in front of people. It's too late. Our attitudes and thinking have to be, if you like, serious. So we can't dodge things. And our practice needs to reflect that. If in practice we never ever play through anything as if we are in performance, then the performance on stage might be the first time we actually do that. That's too dangerous. That's outright dangerous. And the fact is that a student who does that, a performer who does that, will damage herself in the end. Because we are our worst critics. Any mistake we make on stage is going to be amplified to our consciousness much larger than anyone in the audience. So that we teachers know that because the student comes off stage sometimes and says, oh, it was really terrible. And we think, what? It wasn't so bad. It was pretty good, actually. So we have often this conversation. But so practice needs to be structured in a way that reflects this characteristic of public performance. And I think one other thing, too, and that's related again to the purpose, performance needs to reflect a certain authenticity. We can't just play because we have seen it on YouTube this way and we think it should go this way. These days it's very tempting to be just an imitator of something on YouTube. And I'm not bagging YouTube. YouTube is a very, very important resource for us, very useful. We can spend many hours on YouTube. But the point is, an imitation of a performance per se is just going to lead us away from the purpose of why we're doing what we're doing. And there's nothing wrong with stealing things from people, actually. So if we like something that we see on YouTube and we can identify with it and we can actually find it inspiring, by all means, do it. But if we don't, if we just think we have to do it because we think that's what's done on YouTube or that's because Hilary and Hahn does it, then we are in trouble, not because of what we do, but because we have eroded the authenticity of our performance. And because we have such a fetishized musical culture, which is always only interested in what the stars achieve and what, etc., you know, the exciting musical works and whether you can play the Sibelius concerto at the age of 8 and a half, etc., because that's a sort of driver of our culture, we tend to take shortcuts. We tend to go to YouTube and say, how is this done? I copy it, and then we move on from there. That's very dangerous because we erode our authenticity as musicians. And as teachers, we must, to a certain extent, discourage that. We must say to people, what do you want to do? An authentic performance, even if flawed, can be very, very touching. And it can be very moving. It can be much better than a slick, polished performance that is inauthentic. And that's what we have to reinforce, because ultimately that's what musical performance is about. And in the long term, we know that untruthful behavior, for whatever reasons, undermines our motivation. It undermines our love for what we do. So we shouldn't underestimate this. We shouldn't underestimate that we want to promote a comprehensive purpose to what we do. And public performance And the whole intent and confidence of public performance comes also from this ustanovka, from this idea that a person stands in front of you who seriously and sincerely believes in what they're doing. So that is something we need to give the students at all times, and that we need to develop as performers and musicians ourselves. Now, interpretation, the second area in where we work. Obviously, we're dealing with very specific music. We have to look at stylistic features, at the way we read this music, at the history, and at the role and importance of improvisation in various areas of this music. We need, people always say, oh, it's very important to know music history, or to know something about the pieces. Why? Why is it actually important? Of course it's important, but why is it important? It is important because the music of a particular time reflects the existence of the musicians and their world. So if we want to actually play in an authentic way, we need to actually understand what that means, and we need to develop a feeling for this. We can't pretend that we can just take a piece of notes, printed notes on a piece of paper and translate it or scan it, translate it in a literal way. All interpretation has a sense of creativity and freedom. There actually needs to be what some people call points of indeterminacy. We cannot determine anything. There must be freedom in what we're doing in this interpretation, and that's our opportunity as well. We want to teach the student this capacity to say, here you can do what you like, or you, why don't you try to free this up here, because the character will be shown to be more exciting or more evocative or whatever you want to say. But it's very important to give the students the sense that there is a discipline, there is knowledge, there is an existence behind this music, and there is a freedom here where you invent yourself. And this is important, it's an important philosophical point, because we can say, and this is again a tendency of our age where we fetishize music, we say music is a representation of feeling. Well, it isn't actually. Music is not a representation of feeling, because feeling itself can't really be represented. Feeling is something we can do and have. But music is what the philosopher Hanslick calls sounding moving form. And a sounding moving form is translated into character. So when we work with our students, we work on phrasing and structure, and therefore say, if we phrase this way, that's the character we get. We work on phrasing, structure, maybe articulation, dynamics, etc. like this. If we start working on feeling itself, as if the student has to feel certain things, we undermine the student's autonomy. Because the feeling in response to music are private affairs, largely speaking. Now, this is a kind of, sounds very dogmatic view, and I appreciate we can have discussions at the end, but I think a conception of music, a sounding moving form, will be much more productive for our work on musical matters too. Because it will allow us to bring to the surface what is actually musical in a piece of music. What is musical in a piece of music is the musical structure, not the extra musical ketchup sauce we put on top. So that's the first thing in that interpretative work. And of course, in the end, all these forms of knowledge, these forms of attitude, they converge in what we call the internal ear. In the end, the student who interprets a piece of music, the performer, the violinist, who interprets a piece of music, thus so through their internal ear, their internal singing. It's not a cognitive, conscious, abstract process. In that sense, it's just a pure singing in your internal imagination. And that's all where the entire work will have to end up. And of course, in the process of learning, in the process of building our performance ability, actually, in that process, we clarify more and more what it is we want to hear. Now, playing together, my third point. Playing together is an important thing to remember, because we need to teach and learn listening concepts. We need to learn that there are limits to automatization, which informs our entire practice routines and our teaching routines. The amounts of repetitions we allow ourselves, the amount of attention that informs our practice. It's no good to repeat something, to automatize it, to serve something that's so-called muscle memory. Guess what? Good news for you. Muscles don't have memory. People have memory. Of course, there are certain processes that are automatic in the sense that they are always available to us. The movement of my mouth is always available to me, at least provided I'm sober. So I don't actually have to worry that in order to form the words to speak to you now. But that's a very low level of availability, and we receive that in violin playing quite quickly, actually. What is not clear to us sometimes is how the correlation between what we imagine to be the case and what will eventually be the case actually functions. And we often withdraw from a failure of that correlation in our fear that things won't work to a process of automatization. And what that does is restricts our attention and makes us unable to play with others. So you get the phenomenon that you get formidably equipped technical violinists, play Paganini caprices for their orchestral audition, and when you put them in the orchestra, they cannot play with anyone else. They are, in fact, often elementary in their ability to do that. Why is that? Because they have learned all their things they can do through process of automatization. And that's actually a very important point, because they are now teaching methodologies around which only entrain the student to pre-molded concepts of video technology. That is very dangerous, I believe, because the cognitive processes that of entrainment are not the cognitive processes that should support musical creativity. Of course, we need to teach our students to a certain extent the social competencies as well. And we need to teach them how do we understand playing together, actually. If we think through it clearly, we know that playing together is not a function of responding to each other primarily, it's a function of thinking together. So we read the cues of the environment and we position our intent at the same point. Yeah? So that's an important thing. You learn that in orchestras, because orchestras are so large that you cannot possibly respond to each other. You need to form congruent intents so you can play together. And we know this. We know that when we get an upbeat, we know where the next beat is going to be. Our intent is unified because we read the cues of the present properly. So this is important. We give this experience to students as well. And we can start methodologically at an early level. I start sometimes with the younger students. Every lesson we play some duets, and we understand how the intuition actually works when we play together. And without much talk, you can say, listen, let's listen to this part now, and we understand each other straight away. So this is very important, this authentic form of music making as an experience of the student's development in order to teach their capacity to play together. Now then, there's of course an area of the art of violin playing which is always at the forefront, so-called technique, instrumental playing. But before we get to technique, and I will talk a bit about technique, we have to remember that there are very many ways we can think about this relationship between instrument and body. We can think of the instrument as a foreign object that we need to conquer, as a thing in space. Or we can think of the instrument like the amputee would think of his wooden leg, as a part of their body, would have to think of their wooden leg. If anyone is interested in this, the philosopher Merleau-Ponty, who's written a book on philosophy of perception, which is very interesting, starts his observations with the study of amputees from the First World War. What a gruesome topic, and you thought this would be fun. But the interesting thing here is that the relationship of the body to an external thing is very different than the relationship of our body to a body part. My finger in space can be considered in two different ways, as an object and as an intentionally available digit of my hand, if you like. At this point, my finger becomes twofold in my consideration. And actually, interestingly, the philosopher Schopenhauer starts his entire metaphysics on this principle, the fact that we can have two attitudes to our body, one as a thing and one as an intentionally driven thing. So what am I trying to say? The violin is part of the body. The violin is not an external object. We integrate the violin into the body, and that makes the entire technical concept differently. This first thing about this idea of how the instrument relates to the body is the question how posture, but we often talk about posture, and I want to talk a bit more about posture. Well, the difficulty with posture is that there is no such thing, because our body is moving at all times. So even if we stand still, our body is still swinging. If we fix our posture, we are stiff, even if it looks right. So this idea that there is a continuous balance at the basis of our playing and continuously to balance is very important in how we treat technical concepts. So there are, in my view, vast methodological consequences from even a simple shift in perspective of how the instrument relates to the body. And of course, finally, the most important thing is that we cannot isolate technique or the instrument from the body and its intent. In fact, all technical work has to be intentional and artistically intentionally so. That has, again, ramifications for things like bowing technique, for example. If you think of bowing technique as a mechanical challenge, as we tend to do, then the strokes that you practice may not be available to you for any artistic intent whatsoever. In fact, your playing will be driven by certain habits to handle the ball. If we go back in history, somebody like Bayeux would always talk about bowing technique in relation to things like nuance or musical ideas. There's no discussion of purely mechanical concepts, which doesn't mean that mechanical concepts are not important, but they are not the full reality. That's what I'm saying. And we can't pretend that practicing vast amounts of mechanical exercises to get us a beautiful straight and even détaché will have ultimately any relevance for our artistry except on a very basic level. And in fact, if we go too far with that and we think this is the only reality of our playing, we might actually do damage rather than good in doing this. A quick reminder how actually performance works in a temporal sense now, because this is also very important, and some of you have already seen it. It's very important for our learning patterns and for our teaching patterns as well. Consider this, the sound of one note, one artistic note, any note you care to think. What happens? There's a consciousness, there has to be an intent. There has to be an intent, which is a complex idea of sound and feel of this note A. Without that, we are not artists. There's no point pretending that there is no consciousness and we don't have to think about what we do. I should rephrase that we don't have to think what we do. It's not about that we think about what we think what we do. So here's the process of creation starts here. It starts in the imagination and in the intent. This is followed by the real thing, the external world event, I call it, which is then, so the sounding tone, we should say, is released into the world. Then, immediately following, the tone is perceived. There's a potentially complex process here of analysis and judgments, and of course they feed back onto the system. So we might be very critical, etc., etc. The tone might not have come out the way we imagined, etc., etc. I want to just stop here and just point to your attention that this has very little relevance for this. In fact, it can't have any relevance whatsoever because temporally they are apart. It's already happened. Yes? The perception will inform perhaps the next intent, but it cannot inform the previous intent. This is very important, because our improvement to our playing comes from here, largely. Why did I say largely? Because of course there is a feedback from the perception to the intent, because we think, maybe I didn't imagine exactly clearly what this should be, so I will rephrase my intent, and therefore I will start this process again. But the main fact is that largely our work is here, in the realm of what we call intentionality, in the way we direct our play. If we've spent most of our time here, which we can by saying, but listen to yourself, this is out of tune, and this is scratchy, and this is that, and this is loose, we actually achieve very little. We achieve a lot of frustration, but we achieve in the end very little, because we never work on this. Oh, we only work on this if we are kind of randomly lucky. What is often the case in playing process is that a student or performer will make a random decision here, so this is not clear, this is unclear, then plays real world event, and perception is overstated. So perception suddenly becomes very important, and everything is negotiated around the perception. But it is a very paranoid reality, because it cannot have an impact on our intention directly. Not saying that practically it does. Of course it has an impact on our intention, but if we don't complete the circle of this work properly, then we will never, ever really be effective. For me, this is one of the most fundamental methodological schemata that we need to remember, both in practice and in teaching. Okay, let's think about movement a little bit more. Because, of course, our playing as string players is movement-based. All our so-called technical concepts are movement concepts, I believe. There are some principles of human movements which are important. I've gone through them in the past, so if you heard them, bear with me. I'll try to be as quickly as possible. When I move my forearm, what moves? What do you see?
Forearm.
Yeah. I'm moving my forearm. My intent is to move my forearm, this part, actively. What do you see moving? My elbow, this part. This part, it is wobbling. It's not just my forearm moving. Everything is moving. My upper arm is moving. My shoulder is moving. Yes? This is very different from a movement of this music stand, where I'm moving the top flat. And nothing else is moving, only the top flat. So in human movement, why is this important that everything else is moving? Well, you can all try it. If you move your forearms and restrict your upper arm, we are in big trouble. We can't actually move our forearms. Please, feel free. So, what would you say to a forearm mover that comes to you for a forearm moving lesson and says, I've practiced for 6 hours to my forearm, and it's not working, it's your fault. Of course, what would you say? Release your upper arm. Allow the forearm to move. It's not your forearm that's the problem, it's your upper arm. It's your upper body is the problem, etc., etc. So we understand that movement has two aspects to it. There's always an active part, obviously, which is the forearm, and there is the passive part. And sometimes we make the most improvement by concentrating on the passive part of the movement. Because if the passive part is not leisured, the movement can't take place. So a master forearm mover that wants to go to the Olympics doing this is best advised, first of all, to ensure that the passive parts of that movement are really completely free, so the reflex of the movement that can drive it as actively takes over. That's the first principle. The second principle is that timing and the rhythm of a movement determines effort and structure. What do I mean by that? Well, I'll give you a simple example. If you get up late in the morning, you have to run for the train to get to school. What's the solution to this? Run faster? Learn how to run? No, of course not. You know exactly that the solution is to get up earlier. So you can see, the timing of your action is directly correlated to the energy you spend. If you get up early, you can walk in a leisurely way. So this schema that I showed before, this schema is quite clear. If this is compressed, or this takes place in a disordered way, the energy we will use to execute our plan is bigger. Yeah? If there's a nice rhythm to these things, then the energy is fine and can be leisurely. This is very important. Because we can work all we like on the energy of our playing, if there's no proper correlation between our intent and our playing, we're in big trouble. So timing and rhythm determine effort and structure. What do I mean by rhythm? I'll talk to you a little bit more about the rhythm of movement in a minute. But the other thing is, we must remember, the next thing is that feeling determines our movement a lot, or entirely. We are psychophysical unity. So a feeling is never just mechanical or even biomechanical, so the principle of active passive movement is kind of biomechanical. A feeling for movement is always characteristic. We are working with gestures, so we can see that in that sense music and technique are actually reflection of the same thing. Our musical characterization is also our technical characterization, if you like. And the other thing is that if let's reflect how we move full stop. How is it possible for us to move? There's a simple example I use, and many of you might have heard it before and seen it before. If I ask you to extend your arm to the side, in free space, come on, whoever wants to do it, and I ask you two things. First thing is drop your arm. You can't do it because you can't fall into the chair. The second thing is you hold your arm again, move your arm with the same speed. What is the difference? Is there a difference, first of all? Is there a difference?
One's more controlled, also.
One's more controlled and one's free-falling.
Yeah.
So if in terms of energy, of course, we would prefer the free-falling one. It's easier, the free-falling. But how, my question is, how do we get this difference? How is it possible to move in objectively the same way, but in different ways? How is it possible?
Is it through the instructions?
Yeah, it's the intent, but it's more than that. The intent talks to our body in which way? In a metaphorical way, because we're not actually dropping the arm. The arm is still on my body, right? Don't make a mistake. I'm dropping the rubber, that's it. That's called dropping, but it's not called dropping. I'm only releasing the arm as if it's dropping. You understand? That's called metaphorical instruction. So we know through our imagination, we have a metaphorical relationship with our body. We actually know how to move as if we are moving in a particular way. And the good news is we can use this to a huge technical advantage. We can actually play as if we are playing differently. For example, a very simple example I give you, I did some work today with the string orchestra, and we had a difficult passage, fast playing. We always play differently when we play fast. Why? There's no reason. The body can do things faster than easily as it can do slow. So if we practice the passage slowly, we practice the feeling of slow playing. When we then play fast, we play fast as if we are playing slowly. And guess what? The improvement is instant and enormous. We often don't even believe it. So that's called metaphorical. Yeah, metaphorane. That's how that means to carry across. We use one concept and carry it across another. And we need to use it this way because our body and our mind have to talk to each other. And how can they talk to each other except through a metaphorical process, because they're not the same thing, if you like. So there is to be a process of transfer from our idea of movement to the movement itself. I think that's very important for our whole technical approach, so-called technical approach. Just a little bit more about rhythm and timing. Rhythm and timing for movement is effectively the most fundamental level of work. So if you want to, you can say music is, the most fundamental phenomenon in music is rhythm, actually. Not pitch, because you can still recognize pieces that are rhythmically identical without actually having any pitch. You can still, you know what this piece is?
Beethoven.
Yeah, you know it's Beethoven, but there's no pitch. So the rhythm is all we need as a lowest definitional structure in music. So rhythm is fundamental to music. That means without rhythm, it ain't anything. So if you just get the pitches without any rhythm, you can't recognize it. And guess what? In technique, it's pretty much the same thing. In violin playing, rhythm is fundamental because rhythm is fundamental to movement. And rhythm regulates most things in our relationship of mind to body. I've already shown you this schema, but Galarman in that sense talks about correlation between mind and body, between conception and muscles, if you like. And of course, rhythm regulates the movement themselves. You can feel the rhythm in the fingers. So for example, the left hand You can feel the rhythm of the left hand clearly. And how do we feel rhythm? What does rhythm feel like? What do we feel when we feel rhythm? Well, we feel a pulse. And we feel a subsumption of energy. We feel a recovery of energy. We feel a kind of cyclic feeling. There's a pulse, and the pulse is recovered, if you like, every time. It's a bit like a heartbeat. Why is that a good rhythm?
It's even.
It's not even. That's why it's a good rhythm. If it was like this, it would be harder. Why?
I think what makes it sound good or feel good is that space in between the actual, is because you kind of know where it's going to come, and it makes you feel kind of good. That makes sense.
It's lazy.
Yeah.
Because there's more rest than action. There's one impulse and two notes. And there's a big rest. We love laziness. And rhythm has actually always rest built in. By virtue of being rhythmic, there's always rest. So that means all our playing, all our movements can always rest. In that sense, they are like walking. When you're walking, what's the astonishing thing about walking is that one leg is always resting. Yeah, you need to think like this. The German satirical poet Ringelnatz says, the most important thing about a sieve are the holes. You need to think invertedly in some ways if you think about rhythm. So a rhythm is felt, and it gives us a great opportunity to mobilize our correlation with the, between body and mind in the spaces between the notes. That's why the famous violin teacher Gingold used to say, we do not practice in notes, we practice in between the notes. Because rhythm and movement regulate all this change. Yeah. And we also realize that for somebody who has not organized the rhythm of their playing properly, will have difficulty thinking musically. So there's no point energizing somebody's musical intent if their rhythmic processes of playing are disorganized. And a lot of technical issues boil down to organization. What's important to realize in all our work on playing, especially on movement, is that the role of intention is paramount. Because even though there is a fact that rhythm sort of regulates itself, if you like, through the feel, so I can feel my fingers moving on the fingerboard, etc., whether they're rhythmic or not, in the end, for those movements to be artistically available, I need to build them into an intentional structure. They need to be part of an intentional structure. So I can noodle around the violin in an easy kind of manner, and it can feel quite good and free, etc. If that noodling is not available to me through intent, then it's not worth that much. Because in the end, I need to play artistically, and the notes need to be available in intent. So what I'm saying is that our practice, our teaching, has to strengthen the level of intent, even in a technical sense. And the area where we work here, and that's important to work, is that we can work on movements even in a silent manner, in a way that we work on the movement through imagination, and not only just through the physicality. Because we want to work on the clarification of organization of movement. And in that sense, thinking through movement is just as useful as doing it. We know, again, from cognitive science, that somebody who sits down and imagines the movement is not distinguished in their mental activity from somebody who actually does the movement. The mental activation that we see from the various areas of the brain in this are exactly the same. And in Edinburgh, I think that they've done these experiments with pianists of people variously being asked to perform different tasks, and it's quite clear. The imagination of movement is just as powerful to teach us movement than the actual movement itself. In some ways, it's even more powerful. And of course, sports people have known this for a very long time. And in some sports, it's absolutely necessary. Think of aerial skiing. If you have a funny practice run and you miss somewhere, you are in hospital for 6 months. If that happened to violinists, we'd have probably better results, because every time you play out of tune, you'd be in hospital, you really think before you play. Okay, this is kind of the first part, which is a little more abstract, but I want to think about now an area which we call commonly technique. And I want to oppose our thinking of technique to the Greek concept of technique. And the Greek concept of technique, the philosopher Heidegger says about it, once upon a time, technique also referred to the bringing forth of truth towards the beautiful. I like this, because these days we think of technique merely instrumentally, as a production process. Yeah? We conquer violin playing through production. Kreisler famously advocated that technical exercises should be used moderately. Why? Because the repetitiveness of technical exercises can dull our intent and our imagination. Now, I get into big trouble with my colleagues if I say this too much. I don't want to be misunderstood. Technical exercises are important. But mindless technical exercises or repetitive technical exercises are completely dangerous. They create what we know as arrested development. In fact, they regress the performance ability of the student or of the performer. And the idea that technique is mental, as Kreisler says, and not manual, I'm not sure if you can read it. Can you read it? Yeah. Is very, very important. All our playing is mental in that sense, of course. But the downside, and Kreisler identifies that too, the technique whose controlling power is chiefly mental is not perfect. I say so frankly, because it is more or less dependent on the state of the artist's nervous system. And that is quite true. And of course, because we live in a time where perfection, technical perfection, seems to be everything, we have to be balanced in this approach. We can't, of course, we have to remember that the technical ability has to still become resilient. I think Kreisler is in some ways a little bit too severe on this. I think the properly schooled and skilled mental control of technique can be perfect just as much as just as humanly possible. And there's no reason and no need for automatization on the technical level. So we have, I want to propose a kind of technique which is much more about conditioning the student or conditioning ourselves rather than a functional process which we break down and make into kind of a production process. Because the concepts that we get at the end of a functionalization are not conducive to performance. They create states of anxiety, they create frustration. And they don't allow us to integrate and unify a performance. What I suggest instead is that we think of technique as a conditioning, and that we think of it as a way of unifying our playing through our imagination. So that means we replace certain concepts, certain beloved ideas. For example, the analysis of our playing, the analysis of playing needs to be, to a certain extent, replaced by an imagination of playing. Because analysis is backward looking. It looks at what has just happened. And that's important, but it's contained, it needs to be contained in its importance. It cannot give us the information necessary we need for the future. What gives us the information for the future of our plan is imagination. Judgment has to be replaced, because judgment creates anxiety states and reactions. It has to be replaced by attention. And the body-mind duality, the idea that there's a mind and a body as a machine, has to be replaced, or will be replaced in this model, by minded body, embodied mind. My finger has the feeling as a piece of minded body. So this is part of my mind. I feel through my fingers the notes. There's no difference between my, or there's no sense that this is just a body or a thing and my mind sort of registered or anything. I feel it directly through the fingers. And of course that goes for everything, movement, kinesthesia, etc. Reaction has to be replaced as well. by action. So a functionalized process which looks at its functionality after the event is always prone to induce reaction in the student or in the player. I've done something, react. But playing is not benefiting from reaction. Playing is benefiting from action, from properly organized action. I think a lot of musicians become paranoid. And they become paranoid because they don't understand or don't remind themselves of the schema that I've tried to outline in the first instance. They don't, they're trying to understand the reality from the wrong end, if you like. Paranoia means the knowledge next to the knowledge. Yeah, outside the knowledge, outside the realm of knowledge. So we have to remember, what's the authentic knowledge of this activity? The authentic knowledge, what is this activity of violin playing really like? And we will develop a confidence because we understand where we have to do our work and where the intentionality has to be changed. And I also think that a proper conception of technique as condition will replace a lot of anxiety and confusion and frustration because it implants or implements clarity and creativity into the process of learning and teaching. One of the things where unification of our playing is very important and central is in tone production. So tone is primary in the sense as a point of connection between mind and body and between left and right in our case as well. I'll come to that in a minute. So to finish off for a little bit, I want to go on to some more concrete technical kind of ideas and see how they actually would be formed out in this context of thinking. I've said already before that the relationship of the instrument to the body is one of including the instrument in the body, of forming a unified movement possibility. So the instrument is no longer a foreign object and that we need to try to manipulate and conquer, but the instrument is actually part of the body, like another arm or another limb of some kind. How do we achieve that? Well, one of the fundamental things is that our posture, our relationship of our body to the instrument is not impacted by the fact that there is an instrument in that sense. So we see often the violin comes to the body and the student in response reacts to the instrument. Right? So the first thing, the instrument has to come to the body completely naturally. That means the body has to be first of all in a the most optimal way of moving with the instrument. And we know that there are certain parameters that we need to look at. For example, standing position, we have three bits to our body, large bits, legs to the hips, main trunk and head. So the alignment of the body, we know if the alignment to the, of the body is slightly out of sync, we get tension in various parts of the body. So we find a free swinging position of the body that allows us to meet the instrument without any change to this. Because the movements of the arms, full stop, are very important to it. They need to be free and balanced within the body. So posture is important because the arm movements need to be, the active arm movements need to be balanced passively within the body. If that's not allowed because there's tension in the body, then as my example of the forearm showed, technique can't be free. And for violinists, particularly important is what happens on the left side. Because the left side has to show large sections of movements of balance. So my fingers move up and down the fingerboard. This has to be balanced by an arm which ends here, not here. So shoulder rest, etc., have to be set up in such a way that the arm, that shoulder movement still works. If the shoulder movement, so-called shoulder movement, doesn't work, then there's a major section of balance missing that balances the left hand. And of course within the hand too, we have to have balance system. The left hand is a pivoting system. I'll talk about this a bit more in another talk. But the left hand is a pivoting system which needs to adjust itself all times. In general, in violin playing, structural and structure is a result of movement, like bicycle riding. You sit on a bicycle not because you sit, but because you move. If you don't move, you fall off. So the structure of a hand position is largely the result of movement. Yeah. So structural introductions have to be kept in some ways to a minimum. And they relate to the joints of the arm. So the joints, wrist joint, forearm joint, shoulder joint, are important because they allow the passive movement to position the hand. So they must stay free. If they don't stay free, then, and they lock, they effectively reduce the limb. So if I lock my wrist, I basically lose my wrist. I lose the disconnect between hand and forearm. So any locked joint is lost to us. So we need to make sure that our students or we ourselves remain free in all the joints. Otherwise we lose the possibility of passive movement. So posture in that sense is actually important, of course, because it enables movement. Not because it's right per se, but because it enables movement. It is a gives us possibilities to move. And that's why we have to work on it so much. We can, of course, work on this balance. I think I've demonstrated before, you can try it with your students. It's always a good fun to practice. If we practice like this, we actually reduce tension in the upper body, and we teach ourselves to be looser in the upper body, and we create activity in the legs, which drives the whole movement of the arms in a much more natural way. So practice squatting, those violinists that are here. I can encourage you, or use balance boards or something like this, to check that the upper body particularly, it allows passive movement. I like to think about the left and the right in two different ways. And I explain to you why. For musical expression, the left hand is of diminished relevance. Why? Well, except for vibrato and some subtleties of aesthetic consideration, like, you know, which finger sounds better or which glissando, etc., etc., the left hand is entirely responsible for the material. The right hand, the bow, is responsible for expression and form. The left hand is not responsible for expression and form in the same degree, anywhere near. But the left hand is responsible for the material. And therefore, the situation is perhaps like a painter. This is the canvas and the paint, and this is the painting and the painter. And if the canvas and the paint cost a lot of money, that's not a good idea. It has to come for nothing and has to be of good quality. So the consciousness involved in steering the left hand should be very low level. There should not be any effort in the left hand. Whereas in the bow, there is intent and continuous structuring and continuous conscious development, because it is always the artistic form that we are driving. I think there's two very different ways to relate to left and right. You're not symmetrical in as a pianist perhaps is, because both hands do form and content. Whereas on violin playing, we are only really, strictly speaking, we have content and form. So we need to think about how the material is given to us in the easiest way. Yeah? Directly from the ear to the hand. Which means we look for no interference, no anxiety. The left hand suffers from a lot of anxiety because of the burden of intonation. The left hand is punished for every intonation slip, right? That is a very bad idea. We need to work with the left hand as if we are deaf, which means implications for our methodology. If we start to work on double stops, it's best to do that first silently, because at least we get a feeling of flow and effortlessness before we have a sound that will punish this hand. Right? Just imagine a learning context, the teachers in this room. Imagine a young person's learning context. This person is coming to us because they love the violin. They want to play the violin. They love music. They're putting bowed to string, and the sound is confronting. Now they're playing double stops. Every double stop is out of tune. First level of punishment. Second level of punishment, every double stop is also terribly uncomfortable. So we get punished twice, by being completely uncomfortable and by playing out of tune. And we know that over time, of course, that will reinforce itself and become more uncomfortable and more out of tune. If we work in a way that we say, first of all, comfort, never mind, out of tune or not out of tune, we're not even interested. Just imagine it is kind of a tune. Now, work until it's really, really comfortable, and you can, of course, have halfway outs where you just practice with pizzicato, for example. So every double stop is balanced, etc., and every double stop is comfortable. If you then put the ball in the string, at least you're comfortable, even if you play out of tune. So you're ahead, right? But that's you laughing, but actually, that's a productive way of looking at it. Because if you're comfortable physically, you have a chance. If you're both uncomfortable physically and play out of tune, you have very little chance. So we need to think of this in a methodological sense, yeah? This burden of intonation. This gives us a huge methodological challenge and opportunity. The other thing, because the left hand is the material, in a funny temporal sense, the left hand has to be ahead. Because if the left hand is too late, we will panic, because we have no material. And a lot of our technical issues are because the correlation between left and right is not really organized. So one very simple methodological instructions of playing that respect that schema are things like if you play a scale, you practice with stops and you place the left before the ball. Almost every playing process can be organized in a simple way. And what you get in that process is, of course, very good. Because you can place the finger, you can release any tension you might have as a result. Before the sound comes, your body's comfortable. Yeah, your hand is comfortable, etc. If that's ignored, simple principle of temporal organization, we always have problems. And of course they reach into areas that are far beyond the technical. The rhythmic principles that govern movement, of course, also apply for the left hand. So finger movement in the left hand needs to feel the recovery. So the finger comes down and recovers at that point as well. What we determine the material in the left hand through feel. And it's very important to observe our finger angles there, because our finger angles determine the pitch. So a student that continues to change the finger angle, and I mean by that, in my view, for example, the finger angle of the fourth finger and third are often distorted to the point that become too square, which tightens the entire hand. We need to work on the finger angle of the fourth to be more slanted this way, because that way the whole turn between three and four in first position will be automatically by default almost in tune, I find. But if we don't observe that, then every time the student plays 3-4, the entire hand tightens and there's no release. So we got to ensure, I believe, from the beginning that we work on these base joint exercises, etc., to make sure that those finger angles are right. I'll talk about this more when I talk about the left hand specifically. Intonation is a huge area of confusion and anxiety for us. It's one of the things that we believe is the most important thing, perhaps 70% of violinists surveyed in the German Hochschule thought it was the most important thing, intonation. And yet we don't often know what we're talking about. I've been on many audition panels where people say, oh, this intonation was very good, and somebody said, what? This intonation was very bad. And these are experts. So intonation is something we often don't agree on. We don't want to talk about it, find it too confronting. It's a very powerful weapon if you want to bully somebody. Your intonation is no good, etc. It's always true. Intonation is never good, because intonation per se is not perfect, because our entire system of acoustic, of tones is not perfect. We You have to make continuous compromises. But nevertheless, of course, there is clear intonation and there is unclear intonation, because intonation is a context-dependent thing. So we need to unravel our intonation determinations and the context in which we play into. And first of all, of course, there are acoustic things we need to know. We need to know that melodic intonation is built on the reference or the derivation through fourths and fifths. So if I want to find a whole tone step in a scale, I will use the fourth, not the sixth. It would be too low, the whole tone step of the scale. Yes? So that melodic intonation benefits from our work with fourths and fifths and octaves, so perfect intervals, and should be derived that way. If we don't respect that methodologically, either as a teacher or as a player, then our intonation will always be inconsistent. That's only a small point, but it's a very important point. We can eliminate probably, I don't know, 40-50% of our intonation troubles if we agree on this principle. And I mean, the literature agrees on it, and people tend to agree on it. So it's very, very simple. We don't have to have these intangibles about intonation that create all sorts of anxiety and confusion. Simple ways of working on intonation by referencing to the bass line, for example, we can immediately eliminate a lot of our troubles. Play with drones, or we get them to sing the tonic and play their scales, which is fun, by the way, try it, etc. So that the referencing of intonation is clear. This is the most important part. The correct intonation has to be part of our attention, not of the reality. It's again, go back to that model. Yeah? Working from our perception into our playing is very, very limited. So there are many methods we can use to improve our intonation, of course, and some of them relate to reducing interference, which comes through tension of the hand, and others are clearer thinking, audiation, etc., referencing or miming, and building listening ahead, which can do that easily. So it's, again, a simple organizational process. I think finally, or more or less finally, because I can see your eyes, I want to talk about the bow. I've said already that the bow, of course, is the forming principle of what we do. Expression comes from the bow, primarily. So the practice of expression without vibrato, for example, is vital because it shows us what actually is the form and sound production really like. If we can play expressively in the bow only without the help of the vibrato, then we have a good basis for the expression. If we then add vibrato and enhance the expression, that is great. It's like making cake. First the cake, then the icing. Don't work on your icing like crazy if your cake isn't any good. Right? You can only cover up that way and confuse yourself. The cake has to be the best, and this is the cake. This is the icing in terms of expression. Yeah? So we often confuse this. We say to a student, play more expressively, use more vibrato. But actually, what we mean is, let's see how your expression works without any vibrato. What is your sounding? Yeah? Play beautifully without vibrato. If you can do that, then you have a basis for the expression. But of course, there are also purely biomechanical principles of the bow, which allows us to move properly. Now, the idea that bowing technique is always expressive, of course, depends on our ability to move. And in the end, the movements that determine our bow are what? Arm movements, largely. But in order for arm movements to work properly, we need to have a functioning bow hand. Again, the bow hand is not a rigid hold, there's no such thing as bow hold, but it's a flexible, you could say, hinge. Galarian has five rotational property, five rotational angles, if you like, that the ball hand needs to actually be able to feel and execute. See if we can remember them. There's the horizontal, the vertical pivoting movement. Yeah? This kind of thing, which we might need in speak up to action slide to determine the likeness of the ball. There's the horizontal pivoting movement. Why is this important? If I go from the heel to the tip, my ball hand needs to ever so slightly slide across the fulcrum of the thumb. So I shorten the angle by slipping the ball hand forward. Yeah, that's, we call this the horizontal pivoting movement. Then there are the finger movements, vertical one, this one, and horizontal. And they're often combined to this, what we call the collet stroke. Yeah? Collet literally means glue. Gluing the ball into the string becomes very important because it's the core of our sound production. And the fifth one is what the French violin pedagogue Capé had identified. Capé was Galland's teacher. Actually, most of Galland's ideas come from Capé in terms of the ball. Capé identifies rouler, so the ability to roll the ball between the thumb and the fingers to allow flexibility of the ball hand across the fulcrum of the thumb, because often we will grip the ball too tightly with the thumb, or there's too much thumb pressure upwards. We roll the ball across the fulcrum of the thumb and the fingers. Really, it's an important exercise for sound production. Yeah. So these are five rotational possibilities of the ball hand, and in some ways they're active. Interestingly, Galamian. Capé identifies the fingers of the ball hand in very esoteric language. At some point he says the third finger is the spiritual leader of the ball hand. Yeah? And he's right, because it's the finger that gives the most tone contact. What is important about our entire sound production, obviously, is the sound point, or the contact point, and its various correlates. I won't go through this now, you know this anyway. And I'll give a special talk about the ball and its determinations. But what is important is that feeling is central to sound production and artistic shape in that sense. So what we need to try to establish is not so much a mechanical movement across the contact point, but a feeling for the contact point. So the contact point becomes actually the center of our attention. That's our voice, if you like. That's our sound point and our voice. And to finally finish off here, I think I need to finish off because it's getting too late. We need to remember that when we integrate left and right, and also our psychophysical ideas into our whole plane, we're always dealing with coordinated bilateral plane. So I've talked about already the temporal relationship between left and right, in terms of left being ahead of the ball to a certain extent. And I've talked a bit about how rhythm organizes movements, etc. And of course, in any technical challenges, we can reduce our challenge to these coordination issues. And we should reduce them. So Flesch already advocates the separation between left and right. And we can do that. I indicated when we practice double stops, we can start with silent practice, we can start with pizzicato practice, or we can practice stop. We are ahead here, which is in some ways a separation between left and right, or we can completely separate left and right by just working on the left hand only in field terms and the ball in open string terms. So practicing this bowing schemata, etc. In the end, complex passages or complex challenges on the violin, we can work with rhythmic patterns. And the idea there is, if we work with the rhythmic pattern to improve coordination, we always work with the concept of anticipation. So that even in fast playing, we are thinking ahead. We may not be able to tell we are thinking ahead, but if we are playing fluently and things work well, we are thinking ahead. And in fast playing particularly, there is a great possibility of, if a student practices too fast, too much, there's a great possibility to disorganize the playing and create panic states. So the easiest way to get across that is to break down a passage into portions and then ensure that there's proper balance in the first instance, followed by anticipation before the play. I see if I can find a place. So we have this passage, yeah? You break it down into passages. I play already the next one. One run in my imagination, then the real thing. And the thing is, we can see this thinking process. Why? We can see the hand preparing. A student that anticipates the playing properly will show different movements because it's logical that way. The hand has already been there or is already there. Therefore, the movement, the actual movement that occurs is much more leisured than the movement that is to be done with intent. Similar to my example of dropping and moving the arm. Yeah? So anticipation of movement is very important in generating different type of movement. It's not just a question of a change in the physicality of the movement, but it's a question that the anticipation of a passage will create a lower energy and much more leisure type of movement. And so we can always identify whether the student thinks or not. Yeah, we can see that. And with a passage like this, we shift the stop in order to compel the student to think again. Because if we're always practicing the one pattern, the mind tires and the anticipation stops. But if we make the student think again, then that's what the student has to do. Okay, well, thank you very much for your attention. I think that might be enough for tonight.
Yes, there are some goodies up the back for anybody that's hungry or thirsty. And once again, thank you very much. Useful, informative, funny. I hope we can all incorporate some.